Now I'd like to introduce David Hyman, who is the managing partner with Kleinbard Bell & Brecker, to give the Friends of Zion Award to Senator Williams.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It's my job to introduce Senator Williams, who is a great public servant in the tradition of the Williams family. I'm here to introduce him as the Friend of Zion. So who is this Friend of Zion? He's a friend who spoke up on behalf of a public school teacher who wanted to wear kippah in class. He's a friend who spoke out against anti-Semitism and BDS efforts on local campuses. He's the author of legislation requiring mandatory Holocaust education. Seems to me he's the favorite choice of the Consul General for speaker at every Jewish occasion. About a year and a half ago, he hosted then Deputy Knesset Speaker Shlomo Mola, an Ethiopian Jew, to meet with the local African American leaders here to build a stronger connection between Israel and African American Philadelphia. He's traveled to Israel both as a participant in a program sponsored by the American Jewish Committee, and most recently, this July, as the organizer of a trip to Israel. This is quite a friend we have, a friend of Zion, a friend of our community. But I know what you're really wondering. Does he pass the test? Is it in his kishkas? Well, I can tell you as somebody that has been to the Kotel with him, that has traveled in Israel with him, that has been to Yad Vashem with him, Senator Williams indeed passes the Kishkas test. It's in his heart, it's in his mind, and that's because he's the kind of person that on a very human level has the ability to cross boundaries of every sort, to make important relationships, to make important connections, to make life better for all of us. It is my deep honor and pleasure to introduce to you tonight's Friend of Zion Award winner, our good friend, Senator Anthony Hardy Williams.
Good evening. Shana Tova. Permit me to wish you all a belated New Year, and may 5774 bring the year of health, happiness, and peace to your families. David is a very, very, very dear friend of mine, and he prepared a text for me to talk about tonight. Of course, David knows me for who I am, and that is everything he wrote, I'm probably not going to say. For those of you who don't know me, there's many, this one you don't know me, I want you to understand something. I arrive at this moment with a great deal of humility. This is a lifelong, not body of work, but a lifelong body of existence. It's how I was raised. Tolerance, fairness, inclusion. I stand before you tonight as a, hopefully, as an example of what human beings should truly be about. God's blessing to all of us is that human dignity should be our most basic contribution to one another. Protection of all of us is the creed of this country. And allowing to speak and be different is the context that makes us all strong. I revel in the distinction. I'm, by all means, a very proud person from West Philadelphia. I'm not an Ethiopian Jew. West Philadelphia has Jews. guy who grew up in a very proud neighborhood of African American professionals and taught us all about what it means to be proud to be American. Of course, during the course of that, meant that my family made sure I knew all about America. That meant it meant a lot of different types of Americans. And many of those happened to be Jewish. They were friends of my family, not people that we were tokens friends. They were literally people who came out, watched us, protected us, were part of us. And then as I grew older, in the 60s, it became even more apparent that that part of the community was destined to be not just friends, but protectors, supporters, and vigilant fighters for African Americans. And so when I arrived in college, Franklin Marshall, a number of my friends who happened to be Jewish, we spent hours, literally hours, debating who suffered more. And of course, they would tell their tales of the diaspora, we would tell our tales of being robbed from Africa, they would talk about the Holocaust, we would talk about the plantations, we would all be exhausted, and of course, as any 18-year-old would do, we would resort to beer. Then the story became legendary. Those friendships exist with me today. And the reason why I'm going to depart from my remarks, that all the things I could talk about that have occurred to me that bring me to this point of being a friend, were exaggerated. Literally 3 or 4 days ago, when I got a note from my office that came from a group, and I'm not going to talk about the group's name. But they represented that they were a Jewish organization concerned about fairness and inclusion in the Middle East. I want you to understand something. I'm not an expert on the Middle East, but I have common sense. I've gone to the Middle East, and I've been in Israel more than one time. I've talked to Israelis, I've talked to Palestinians, I've talked to Jews, I've talked to Christians, I've talked to Muslims, I talked to everybody. And the last time I went, I took a delegation, half Jewish, half African American, some Muslims, some non Christians, all of us went. And so when I got this letter, it basically said I should not come before you tonight and accept this award because the organization represented intolerance and unfairness and imbalance. And they represented, they referenced, frankly, one of the most outstanding honorees that you'll hear from later tonight as a representation of intolerance. I was not only shocked, I was stunned. I was stunned because, one, I can't say I know the whole history of this organization, but I know enough the organization because the people who are in the organization. So needless to say, for those who know me, you know, the last thing you want to do is nudge me based upon my friendships. So I got a letter from 125 people who purported to be Jewish and they were concerned about the Palestinian state and encouraged me not to come here tonight and in fact threatened me and said if you appear there, you see this airport, we are going to send a letter to the press tell them that you are intolerant towards other communities, particularly the Islamic community, the Muslim community, which is part of my vision. So my staff, of course, were a little bit paralyzed by those set of circumstances and were concerned about my political future. Understand, I don't do this work to have a political future. Matter of fact, I do a lot of work that probably would end my future. Because when moments like this confront me, I can only resort to one thing. My dad taught me that money's going to leave, your health may leave, all your physical attributes may leave. My wife is one right in front of you, by the way. Hers have not left her. By the way, I need to introduce my wife, Sherry Williams. My baby sister, Lana, her husband, here. My uncle Norman is celebrating 85 years old. My dad is going on to glory, but my mother is still with us. She is also here. So as they all know, when people confront me with challenges, I can only resort to what my father told me. The thing that will last is your character. It will be a testament to who you are. The Jewish community and the African American community locked arm in arm over 40 years ago to provide civil rights for all Americans. All of us. So when people upon the integrity of my friends, then I can only resort to one thing. You're not a friend. You're not a friend. And so what I did was, I penned a nice little response and said, I checked with all my rabbis, I checked with all my friends, I checked with a number of organizations, and by the way, don't ever show up in my office again. Technology, somebody's recording this. So I want to make sure you get it on the video tape. I don't apologize for what I said today. I've been in the Middle East. I was there when they just recently talked about the peace talks. Now, I wasn't invited, but I will take credit for at least they occurred around when I arrived. The truth of the matter is there are a set of circumstances that all human beings should not be confronted with in the Middle East, but guess what? Those who live there by some basic principles that all of us in America abide by. They want their families to survive in peace. And by the way, there are Palestinians who work and live and enjoy friendships in Israel. Oh. And by the way, they actually believe that Israel should exist. Regardless of what the newspapers may misprint, regardless of what some people in my community have forgotten, regardless of what this group obviously doesn't remember, there is a state of Israel, not just because Jews wanted it, but because the world demanded it. Israel is not a mistake. It is not an affront. It is not a robbery. Matter of fact, it is a contribution and a reason that sometimes is not only sexist, but racist and ignorant to democracy. My words are not spoken as a politician tonight. My words are spoken as an African American who's proud of who he is, but recognizes that he stands here because some of your family died in the South. Some of your family spent money to contribute to lawyers. Some of your families fought cases. Some of your families gave a damn about another human being that didn't look like, wasn't registered, didn't come from the embryonic cord that you came from, but cared about human conditions. I'm proud to carry this conversation. I'm proud to be a part of it. Shalom.